I'm Stephan Morrow. I'm a Clifton, New Jersey resident and a local filmmaker and also a theater artist in New York City. And as I was filming an independent feature called Dog Mouth, written by John Stepling, I noticed that we were filming in different woodlands that the trunks of trees would disintegrate rapidly if they were, after they fell down, they would disintegrate pretty quickly. But the root systems were apparently made of a harder wood, so they would remain, and they formed some, after a while I started noticing how beautiful the shapes of these root pieces were, and so I started collecting them with no particular, I just thought they were just so beautiful, and they were just disappearing into oblivion. They were rotting away, turning into sand, dirt. So I started collecting them, and then they started, as they sat on in my balcony, I started putting them together in different shapes. And so they became sculptures eventually. And the Clifton Library, which I'm a big supporter of, I believe in libraries, was very kind and allowed us to have a gallery exhibit of the art here in the Clifton Memorial Library. It's fascinating to me that pieces of wood are just lying in the woodlands, and every time a development goes up, we lose, you know, hundreds, thousands of trees, and I think they're becoming almost like an endangered species. So my idea was to maybe kind of instigate an appreciation of their beauty, of the frozen motion. It seemed to me that there were like frozen motion in wood, somewhat related to driftwood, but minus the sand element, so that it didn't have that washed out look and rounded edges. It really had these, a lot of interesting, unique, unusual and eccentric shapes that then I put together in pieces to become a sculpture in and of themselves. My self-imposed limits was that I couldn't use any adhesive, so I just put them together as pure assemblage. In the exhibit here, some are hanging. I used some thin cable. I did do that. But that's basically what I saw the pieces as, just assemblies of pieces of root in what I thought was the most interesting way possible. So this I gave them names sometimes. This I call Winged Victory. There was something triumphant in the shape of this. I also loved the rounded hook end of this. And in this piece, the veins of the wood really stick out, both in this bottom piece and then in this top piece here. So it had a sort of a forward thrust. And again, in this particular piece, the striations of the wood, the veins that are still there, to me are just absolutely beautiful. They're like frozen motion in wood. This I called Solid Bonfire. Now this is interesting. This was a small cedar tree that someone had cut about 3 feet up from the ground, and then they had just wrenched out this huge filigree root system that had been in the ground. So I was riding in my car literally and saw this in front of somebody's house. And it caught my eye, and over several days I passed back and forth, and I said, you know something, I think there's something to this. So the man was very happy, the city hadn't picked it up. But cedar has a wonderful, beautiful red taint to it. So what I did is I turned it upside down, and I actually washed it quite a bit, because this is all full of dirt. But I got some spray polyurethane, and it really gave a sheen to this wonderful system, the filigree of these tiny, thin little roots. And then in the middle, as a finishing touch, I put this little blue cone, something, it just struck me that it might be an interesting punctuation. This piece, again, was actually two pieces. This is a natural formation that was in the woods that I found. It's a remarkable U shape. Nature had just bent it in a perfect U. And this was another piece that I just thought was really beautiful. I like the lines and the shape of that and that slight bevel in the middle. So I put it together and I called it Odysseus because it had a kind of a forward sense to it. This is an example of where the trunk has disintegrated, but the place where the branch came out just formed this amazing shape, and I call that nebula. I would say that's a fairly representational description. You know, the Orion Nebula has sort of a shape like that. This was really interesting. The lower piece almost looked like something underwater. You know, like Atlantis. It reminded me of Atlantis somehow, and I just saw the beauty of that. I washed it. It was actually eaten by some kind of wood worms that were still in it when I first got it. But the stain quickly made them move out. And then I had this other piece that I did not varnish or stain or anything, and. And I stuck it onto another piece below you can't see that's holding this. And this piece I call aardvark. It kind of had that sense to me of an aardvark. I don't have a name for this, but if you can see, there's a chain that was actually growing through the trunk of this particular piece of wood. And the sense of time and the slow growth of wood actually growing around a piece of chain. So then there was a beautiful rounded hole in the back of that, and I decided that this curving piece of wood here would be appropriate to come out of the rear opening. And I like the fact that it's on the upper right corner of this platform. That's deliberate. And I like things sometimes a little bit off kilter. It's sort of interesting that way. So now this piece, I just love it. It's got this really gnarled kind of two-branched, in a almost like outstretched arms, dare I say it, although I discourage people from saying it looks like that or it looks like this, reminds me of, I just like the impact on its own identity, on its own merit. And the bottom is sort of like a pedestal, and it came out of that, it held that, so it raised it up a little bit. And I think it's a very striking piece. I loved how the insides are revealed of the two branches. And it had a kind of something of the graveyard, in it. I call this catharsis. The frozen motion in the wood is just stunning to me. And how it comes down and around. So that motion, I sense this was, I find a title that just, it speaks to me, so I use it. I call this catharsis. Okay, so here, I call this Jupiter. There's something very, male, powerful, very hefty, solid, has gravitas. And it still has a sort of a forward projection. I also liked the rear shape, this roundish shape. Now again, these are all parts of the bottom part of a tree somewhere that has been, it slowly is revealed. They used to talk about Michelangelo's statues being, he would reveal them. They were living in the blocks of marble that he would receive, and then he would release the marble block that they were in. And I felt the same thing about this. The time, time and water had released this shape from some part of the wood of the tree. So Now this I really like because these are two pieces, and again, nature curved this on her own. Essentially, Mother Nature is the sculptress, and I just put together pieces that she's already made. So, but I just thought this is a beautiful piece of wood here. Again, the striated lines are in a very dynamic kind of frozen motion, but with an aggressive, but a female aggression with this. I call this Amazon. Now this one is interesting because all the pieces are being hung on the wall, but this has a forward projection, a protuberance coming out of its middle, and a very male, aggressive kind of shape. And the fact is, I found some very shiny glass-like coating, polyurethane, and it made it almost look crystalline. So, and it changed the color. So I just thought this is very interesting and very male aggressive. I called it Spartan, as some kind of remembrance of the Spartan warrior tradition. This one, again, in a kind of representational manner, I call Thermopylae. I mean, the fact is, I just thought it was a lovely piece of wood that was split in the middle, and so I used another piece of wood that was of a very different texture, very thin, and on top was something that resembled maybe kind of like a Spartan warrior's helmet. Although, again, that's way too representational for my taste. But now, this piece is an extraordinary piece that nature shaped. It was part of a root system that lasted far longer than the tree, whatever that was. And so I was just so knocked out by the shape, the different pieces of wood, coming out spiked out of this thing, that all I did was I put some, I washed it and I put some polyurethane, and it gave it almost a plastic look while preserving all the different spiky pieces that came from its core. And it's being hung on another piece up there, and that's I call this Howl. Of course, there's a famous poem that Allen Ginsberg wrote by that name, and I don't know, for some reason that struck me. Now this one down here, is actually two pieces. This on the bottom had just this wonderful circular system of roots. The roots had grown in a complete circle. And then it has this wonderful elephantine kind of skin. And on top it had this beautiful little root system that someone had chopped off. And somehow the name 30 Sisters came up to me. Now this one, and I just loved the shape. It reminded me of a Giacometti kind of sculpture. And I had this other piece of very light colored wood with the path of different either worms or some kind of wood insect that had made these beautiful labyrinth patina of labyrinth shapes along its skin. And again, I thought this is something, aggressive about it, so I called it Napoleon. But what I love about it is the way the two pieces kind of interconnect. They hook into one another, there's something, they're charging. It's a piece that seems to be a frozen motion of a charge. And certainly that kind of reminded me of Napoleon. This was a favorite piece of mine early on. I call it Cleopatra. There was something very queenly about, and you can see, now this is actually, these were growing. These are in the ground. The top of it was in the ground. So I turned it upside down, and it became almost like a crown. And I added a piece on top. But it's the aristocratic sense to this piece made me think of Cleopatra. And I placed it on top of a wooden platform that had a very interesting division in the middle of it. If you see the bottom has it's folded in, and then it has a sort of a groove in the center. And I didn't treat that at all. But there's something like a coronet or a crown about this piece. And this piece here, again, has a very formidable shape to it. It seems like these spindly roots. This is, again, all part of a root system. I didn't do very much to this one. There's a little stain on it. I saw it as a kind of a female, but one with fury. You could almost see it as a gorgon, the deity with snakes for hair, but in an aggressive attack mode. These are two pieces of root that I put together. And again, I was enamored of this bulging piece of the wood that came out here. And the other piece on top, again, has some beautiful skin to it. And putting it together, it just somehow reminded me of Hamlet, the Prince of Denmark. But mostly it's just an interesting piece of these two pieces put together into one identity. And the piece next to it here is what's fascinating to me about this piece is that it's actually two pieces of wood that I've attached into one piece, and I just love it's almost like a curving piece of water frozen in wood, like almost like a wave. I call it dragon's blood. Actually, these are in this is my ode. I call it my love for Louise, which is a tribute to Louise Nevelson, who is famous for making big sculptures of pieces inside of square boxes. And this is kind of the same. This is the male, the top is the male part, and the bottom is the female part. And it is kind of a love letter to Louise. God rest her soul, rest in peace. She was a wonderful sculptress. And would actually do the same kind of thing. She would go along New York City streets and collect pieces of junk that people had thrown out, and then reassemble them into fantastic monochromed black and white sculptures in boxes. Now this one here, next to that, I call this King Lear. In that limb here, this exposed part of the limb, and the top seemed again almost like some kind of a helmet, and I just thought of King Lear when I looked at it. Out of the whole series of sculptures, this one is actually the most anthropomorphic of the exhibit. I call this Cleopatra's daughter. And there's something, you know, there's clearly something I'm hanging some pieces on, just a very pedestrian piece of kind of shelving. But the pieces coming out of the head, there are actually two eye holes in this, and then some kind of a trunk coming out. But I call it Cleopatra's daughter. Now, this piece, the bottom piece was just absolutely stunning in both the shape and the way it took the stain and the polyurethane, and then how the other piece fit so exactly and perfectly into it. And I loved how the top piece curves out almost as a sort of a grasping limb. But the whole thing together, I thought, was just a beautiful shape. Now this one is probably the biggest piece in the collection, and what happened was in my journeys looking for wood, I saw this big wooden box that someone had homemade into, and they had varnished it and stained it. And I had found the other piece, this large piece of limb that had been wrenched out of the trunk with a jagged edge, a kind of a spear-looking tip to it. And then I put this sort of like a head-looking thing on top, a piece. And it became a rather interesting juxtaposition of man-made wood, out of which this this natural piece of, a large piece of wood came. And I thought it made an interesting piece that way.